Thank you, Principal Nayak, and let me congratulate you again on behalf of all our members and teachers and students. It's a big achievement, yes, on the part of Vidya Prasarak Mandal. But what we have achieved is because of teachers and students of Polytechnic. We are very proud of you. I can see Principal Muzumdar sitting there, your predecessor. Well, friends, really a few words. As Principal Nayak has said, this is the fourth lecture we are organizing, and the idea behind organizing these lectures is to invite a very competent personality in respective fields, maybe in humanities or sciences, and who would contribute something original to the knowledge process. That's the basic idea. We have just started. The whole idea is that. Second idea is not also to defy a person whom we respect so much. At least all of you here, they fully know what Dr. Bedekar was. So we don't need any elaborate words on him. Every one of us, we know that. The best thing what we can contribute to him or his memory is his life mission, that is the advancement of knowledge. And if we can do that, in whatever form we can, we should do that. And that is the basic intention of organizing these lectures. And I hope, and I am sure, I am confident that in future we'll have many speakers, those who would be presenting their original work on this forum. For today's subject, I know that when the invitation was distributed, when I used to come in this campus also, many people were probably avoiding me. Only one paragraph, but even then, some of them were very courageous to ask me, Doctor, what is the subject of this year's speech? I won't blame them. Because that is the exact situation of today's India. Phenomenology and deconstruction are two tools of knowledge or systems of or methods. There are many more that the modern science, be it sciences or humanities, are studied. I myself was so ignorant, but I was lucky that I could somehow get over those obstacles and get some insight into what these subjects are. Now friends, whether we like it or not, but what we learn today, what we talk today, what we communicate to each other today, as what we call it as a science, when philosophy is taken as a science, it is a university degree and diploma and postgraduate courses we conduct. So it has a framework of some scientific background behind it. Now whatever science we now learn is again a 100% Western methodology. All our words we use are Western words, English words, many of them are Greek words. Very few of them, even the best of the teachers, we have found that they don't try to understand what the meaning of those words is. I here mean a history of the how that word has come into existence. We are going to listen to. Luckily, we had our speaker about a couple of months back here as a keynote speaker to our one of national seminars on Indian philosophy, and he spoke so well. And there itself I requested him, can he elaborate more on these two topics? Well, friends, whether it be existentialism or surrealism or phenomenology or deconstruction or modernism or postmodernism, these are all terminologies of great thinkers, philosophers of 20th century. Maybe some of them, process may have started in the late 19th century, but by and large they have the creation of early 20th century. Now why did they have to think about this? Why these words came into existence? How did they travel to not only in philosophy, even in medicine now? Many of the medical books they very fluently and very easily they use these words of phenomenology and deconstruction and modernism and postmodernism. Because they travel, the ideas they travel, the processes they travel. If one word is used in one particular field to explain some phenomena in other discipline of sciences, we use those words. So one must understand what they are, and they are very important. They are very important from the point of view of how Western society has evolved. It is very important from the point of view of how Western society has formulated their views. Many of you may not be knowing that the deconstruction is an actual kind of, I won't call a revolution or a revolt, but Derrida in his all articles and books he has been writing about Western philosophy, psychiatry and the language of sciences, and he has very elaborately explained there why he wants to deconstruct it. Same is true with the phenomenology. It has something to do with the human existence, understanding what we are, understanding what our contribution is, understanding what do you mean by a particular philosophy or for a particular subject. And that's a basic question for Indian seers, Indian thinkers, Indian philosophers in the traditional Indian philosophy. About 2000 years back or earlier than that, Indian seers failed. Who am I? From where have I come? Where am I going to go? What's my relevance? What's my contribution to this world? And that's how they started thinking, and excellently, very precisely, well explained language Upanishads explained them to the world. No wonder many scientists of the early 20th century, contributing immensely to the modern science, were influenced by the philosophy of Upanishads. Now I personally feel that we have two lectures. Today is that phenomenology and deconstruction with the Indian tradition. Tomorrow we have philosophy of Upanishads. It should have been reversed, that philosophy of Upanishads and then these two modern trends. Well friends, that's the reason why we have chosen these subjects. They are not difficult, they are not any that way now new subjects. They are at least couple of them are couple of decades and couple of them are few centuries old now. Not centuries, but at least one century old. And as a student of science, all of us must try to understand. And if that happens, I see many science and humanity teachers here sitting, though very few compared to our strength of colleges, they will take some inspiration in this and try to involve themselves more in how to understand these processes, so they can explain their students better how these processes are, what these processes are, and what these things mean to we all as a humanity. Though they are, they have emerged out of a Western philosophical continuity from Greek, Christianizing the whole Greek philosophy, and in the then background, why 20th century? They have a background of First and Second World War. They have a background of very rigid philosophy and theology. So they kind of revolt against that was that. Again, I would say, our professor can elaborate on that, that most of these words were related to art and literature. However, they have been used very, very with same meaning and same emphasis on all branches of knowledge now. So friends, we have a very eminent, competent speaker and we all are waiting for him. So I invite Dr. Bal Subramaniam for his speech now. Thank you very much.
Principal Naik, Dr. Bedekar, my colleagues in the teaching profession, distinguished invitees and scholars and students assembled here. This is my second visit to this institution. I am immensely happy to be here, particularly on the occasion when we are assembled here to pay our tributes to one of the greatest architects of education. Vasudev Bedekar. It is a memorial day, and I am happy to see Dr. Bedekar and his family and others who are closely associated with the genesis of this institution, educational complex. And all of us are happy, not only happy, but we are genuinely proud of the achievement of those connected with this institution. I am supposed to speak about Indian tradition, phenomenology, and deconstruction, but to start with, based on the Indian tradition, I would like to associate this particular function with what we have been asked to practice in our tradition. Tradition is great, memorable. The only thing is, very often, the moment we mention the name tradition, we become allergic to it. Nowadays they say the word allergy should be replaced by another word, intolerance. Medically they say, my son the other day was telling, Pa, you have to change the word allergy today. Rather speak as intolerance. The system is intolerant to something. That is allergy. We are allergic, we are a little intolerant to the tradition, because the moment we speak of tradition, we think, oh, we are going backward. We are not really going backward when we speak about tradition. On the contrary, we say the tradition urges us to go beyond, to go forward. And it provides us enough strength and vitality to go ahead with our own program. That is the greatness of tradition. In our tradition, there is a concept, a very important concept of Panchamahayagna. In fact, the term looks very complicated because I use the word yajna. Panchamahayagna, five great sacrifices. The word yajna has got many meanings, not necessarily one meaning with which we ordinarily think of it. Kindling the fire and doing, offering oblations and all that one. That is only one aspect of the application of the meaning of the word yajna. The word yajna also means constant thinking, contemplation on something that is very great. For example, one can practice yajna with regard to the Vedas and the Upanishads and all the other kinds of sacred literature that we have. Artha chintanam, sada artha chintanam, that is yajna. If, for example, Dr. Bedekar is thinking about the growth and development of this institution every day, on every occasion, it is a kind of yajna. That chintana, that artha chintana, sada artha chintana. Now in the tradition we have been told that we have to practice Panchamahayagna. As I told you, whenever I address any Western audience or a mixed audience, I to talk about tradition and Mahayagya, Pancha Mahayagya and all that one. I don't start with this expression because I know that many people assembled may not be willing to listen to this expression. I would talk about heritage. Heritage is an acceptable term. There are five kinds of heritage that we can boast of. Because we are born in a society, we have been sustained by the society, nourished by the society, and therefore we are what we are today because of the society. We forget the fact that we are living in the society. The language that we speak is the language transmitted to us by the society. Ever since a child is born, there is this socializing process. And so, we have to acknowledge five kinds of heritage. Five kinds of heritage. There is, first of all, spiritual heritage. There is a cultural heritage, secondly. There is the biological heritage, third. The fourth, the social heritage. The fifth, the heritage connected with the subhuman species, what we call today the biodiversity, the ecological diversity. If I use these terms, they are acceptable. What is called spiritual heritage is called Deva Yajna, the Yajna or the obligations that we owe to the spiritual heritage. Whether we like it or not, we have been shaped by their heritage. Sometimes we are not aware of it, just as we are not aware of the contribution made to us by our own parents, by the family tradition. So there is such a thing called spiritual heritage which is supporting and sustaining us. That is one yajna. There is again the cultural heritage transmitted by the rishis from the past. That's why we do the rishi yajna. People who are doing brahma yajna, well, they are aware of this as a part of the process that they do. What a kind of heritage that we have received through the sages. We do not know anything about their biography. They didn't care to tell us. That is their greatness. But they have given us the entire corpus of the Veda with all the angas. Rich heritage. And our literary antiquity goes to the Vedic period, the second heritage. The third heritage is immediately something connected with all of us. The biological heritage, what we have inherited from our parents and great parents and the family tradition. We don't pay attention to that. If you are a student of psychology, one of the basic lessons will be how both environment and heredity shape your personality from the beginning. The moment you are conceived, that is the impact of both heredity and the tradition, environment. That is the third heritage. It is a part of the heritage, the third heritage that is being perpetuated today here in this hall in the form of the memorial lecture. The Baedeker family and other associates are remembering this day as a memorial day. It is a kind of a Pitru Yajna. the third one, how great it is. And following this third one, there is what is called the social heritage. We have to show our obligations to our fellow beings. We live with them, we are closely connected with them. Unfortunately, today, when we live in a multiple complex, we do not know who the neighbor is in the other flat. I don't know. How do you expect me to know my neighbor if it is a spread out houses, the village or the community? No. We are uprooted, therefore we don't know our background. We owe an obligation to our fellow beings. That is also being remembered today in the form of education. To educate the people is one of our obligations. The best way in which we can see that the society grows is to provide the basic, fulfill the basic needs of education. That has been done by starting these institutions. Two of the yajnas they have already done. The third is what I call the biodiversity, the ecological heritage, to show our concern and care for the subhuman species, the plants and animals. All these put together constitute Panchamahayajna. What is wrong with that? The only thing is, they don't put it that way. If you go to a traditional scholar, Pandit, they will say, this has to be done only by a grahastha. Where the difficulty arises. Yes, it has to be done by the grahastha, even by others. This fivefold yajna, as I understand it, goes beyond all kinds of barriers and distinctions that you can think of. Caste barriers, gender barriers, all of them do that because you are human. And to be true to be human, you have to acknowledge the spiritual heritage, the cultural heritage, the biological heritage, the social heritage, and finally, the ecological heritage. If you do that, we fulfill all the requirements of the Panchamahayajna. We are worthy of living in the community only if you do that. I am happy that the Bedekar family and the other associates are remembering the great person Vasudev Bedekar on this occasion. I don't want to elaborate on that. I would speak more on that, the heritage. But let me move from that heritage. And before I take the next move in my lecture to you, I would like to give these two books to Dr. Bedekar. And let me read what I have inscribed. These are my own books. I didn't buy the book and give him. I have written the books and I thought that I should share this with him. This is a primal spirituality of the Vedas, its renewal and renaissance. I like this book. My friends who read this one, they say this book. See, just as their parents would be happy to see the child and say, oh, I'm happy about my boy, my daughter. Even so, I'm happy about my own book. And I have inscribed that to Dr. Bedekar. I didn't even put the first name because it could be taken by anybody, Bedekar's son, Bedekar's wife, anybody belonging to that Bedekar family, in appreciation of his devotion and a commitment to health and education. And health and education, both of them are connected with what I call the social heritage. People should be healthy. People should have that mental health through education. health and education fostered by tradition. This is one work. This is the Naishkarmya Siddhi of Sureswara Acharya, the great stalwart, one of the direct disciples of Shankara, and who contributed a lot to Advaita, who differed from his master. He agreed with his master. Where necessary, he would differ from his master. That is Sureswara, the Vartikakara. I also inscribed the same thing with slight changes in appreciation of his devotion and commitment to health and education, which sustains society as fostered by the eternal tradition Sanatana Dharma. This Pancha Mahajna is part of the Sanatana Dharma. Then word Sanatana Dharma is quite acceptable, provided you unlearn what you have learned recently and then try to go back to what it really meant when it was used, Sanatana Dharma.
I'm happy. I'm calling an occasion to give you this one. Thank you.
And one more word about this souvenir. And we must remember that a souvenir is a kind of a record of the achievements that we make from time to time. That's why every year sometimes an institution brings out a souvenir. It may appear to be a very casual publication. It's a ritual we go through. But every ritual has got its importance. From time to time, we have to take stock of what we do, what we are intended for, what we plan to do. And all the three dimensions have been fulfilled in this souvenir. I'm very happy to release it on this occasion. I get into the main aspect of my lecture. I said is also connected with the tradition. Since it is a mixed audience, I will speak to you in a way in which some of the ideas that I want to convey could be understood. And then we have to do something with regard to our education, our tradition, and our way of living. Generally we say, we have to make a kind of a distinction between at least four important aspects connected with our tradition, with our life. First is information. The second is knowledge. The third is wisdom. And the fourth one is art of living. About the art of living, you know that there is so much of publicity. I don't want to say propaganda, so much of publicity by high-tech Swamijis. High-tech Swamijis. I am just quoting from T.S. Eliot, one of the great inspiring modern poets. These are the lines almost verbatim I am quoting. We have lost knowledge in information. Where is knowledge we have lost in information? Where is wisdom we have lost in knowledge? Where is life we have lost in living? This is T.S. Eliot. We require information, but mere information will not be knowledge. We have to move up. That information, all the data that we have must be processed, systematized, and then as a result of systematization it must be integrated totalized, then only we can have what is called knowledge. Knowledge in all aspects of the term. But mere knowledge alone will not do. Much more than knowledge do we require. We require wisdom. And it's a kind of a progression that we make from information to knowledge to wisdom. And then what is wisdom for? Wisdom is to help us achieve what is called spiritual transcendence. We must go up spiritually. We must improve ourselves, improve our life, shape our life and go towards a goal. On the contrary, we are having only what is called living. We are struggling how to live. And therefore, there is no question of our realizing the values of life. And you know that particularly the predicament of people today who are in IT. They don't have any time sense. In the morning they go, they turn at 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock. And both husband and wife, they work in two different places. They have got children. And imagine the condition of the children. They bid goodbye in the morning when the child is sleeping. They come back home when the child is sleeping. And then they give their kisses, flying kisses. Tata, they go to the office. That is living. And therefore T.S. Eliot says that at every stage we lose something. Knowledge we lose in information, wisdom we lose in knowledge, and the value of life we lose in the mechanical living that we have. Now I mention this just to show that in the Indian tradition, this basic issue was raised long back. What is it that has to be known? What is it that is worthy of knowing? Because unless we know what has to be known, we will be going in all the different directions. And therefore the tradition made a distinction between two kinds of knowledge. Aparavidya and paravidya. Aparavidya is what we call literal meaning lower knowledge. Lower in the sense it is a knowledge concerned with our day-to-day life in all its aspects, empirical life. That is very important. In addition to this, we have to know also the higher knowledge. From the one, we have to move to the other. From the lower to the higher. That is the principle of education. Educational methodology consists in proceeding from the known to the unknown, from the lower knowledge to the higher knowledge, from aparavidya to paravidya. In the Mundaka Upanishad, the beginning itself, it says, dve vidye veditavye. There are two kinds of knowledge which have to be acquired. Veditavya, it is a vidhi, injunction. It is not a recommendation, but it is something that is mandatory. And the lower knowledge comprises everything. The study of the Vedas, Vedangas, study about everything connected with our life, with this world. And a person who is able to successfully master the lower knowledge and the higher knowledge, he attains the goal, we are moving towards the goal, because it is impossible for us to lead a life if it is with any kind of a goal. We may not be able to achieve the goal, that is one thing. But our efforts must be to improve our life, to improve our knowledge, to achieve some kind of a transcendence, what is generally called spiritual transcendence. We move. We have got our value system, we have changed our value system. We don't live only at the bodily level. From the bodily level, we move to the sensory level. We care for the bodily values, sensory values, social life, social values, intellectual values, aesthetic values, religious values. So we grow in our value system. A person who is still concerned only with the basic economic values, bodily values, he will not be able to make any progress in his life, in her life. And once a person is able to move gradually, achieving what is generally called spiritual transcendence, there is nothing mysterious. Spiritual transcendence means not that you go up somewhere, no. In the present life that you lead, if you can make it meaningful, if you can make it purposive, then you are in the path of what may be called spiritual transcendence. And this is the message that has been taught in the Upanishads. There is a kind of an assurance or a safety a person has. And if a person can have that kind of an assurance in his life, what it is, it's very difficult to spell out. A kind of an assurance, a kind of a safety. It is not through just financial security, no. More than the financial security, we should be able to have that moral security and the emotional security. Family can contribute, community can contribute, society can contribute. And Yajnavalkya tells the King Janaka in the course of a dialogue, well, who this Janaka is, we do not know, not necessarily the father of Sita. We don't know. A great person, a great ruler. And Yajnavalkya, in one of his discussions with King Janaka in the court, he says, "Oh Janaka, you have attained a stage of attaining security. You have become fearless. Abhayambhi Janaka Praptosi. You are no ordinary king or emperor. You have that assurance, that security. But remember, this is not just an antiquated traditional message. I change the scenery. This is what Wittgenstein says today, said today. And people are very much interested in studying Wittgenstein. They go to any university, the area of research will be around Wittgenstein. Is the language theory and earlier language, later theory, all that. They are the views which are in the circumference of Wittgenstein, not in the core. But the core lies elsewhere. We are just moving only in the circumference, in the periphery. And in the core, there is the mystical side of Wittgenstein. He has indicated that here and there, all the time. And whenever those sentences occur, scholars would say, oh, here Wittgenstein has become mystical. Because they would like to have a rigorous analysis. Karnapadadas. They expect only that. They are interested only in that. Wittgenstein fulfilled the requirements. but there is something more in him, that something more is not wanted by them. Whenever we deal with those passages, they will say, oh, here is a little mystical. That means you just ignore it. Is it a statement that has been made by him in his mental derangement? No. Take the statement like this. What cannot be said, what cannot be spoken about can only be shown. There are things which we can speak about. There is something which we cannot speak about, which can only be shown. Who can show? A master who has already seen, realized that can show that. Not everybody. A master who has that experience can show that to the other person who is willing to be guided. Just as Sri Ramakrishna, when challenged by Swami Vivekananda, Narendra, have you seen God? He says, yes, I have seen God. In the way, same way as you see me, as you see things. How can you demonstrate that one? He just touched him. That was a total transformation of the consciousness of Swami Vivekananda. What cannot be spoken about can only be shown. Wittgenstein. The same Wittgenstein in another place says, look at the statement, I am safe. Nothing can injure me whatever happens. I am safe. Ramana would say, Ramakrishna would say, because they have that authentic experience. They will not tum-tum. But when you question closely and then be with them, safety, that assurance. It is that kind of an assurance that Yajnavalkya tells Janaka, Janaka, abhayam vai Janaka praptosi, oh Janaka, you are in the state of that security, that safety, abhayam, free from fear, bhayam, abhayam. That is tradition. And Wittgenstein speaks for the tradition. And when that's why I say that we have to study the Western text, we must keep an open mind. Because here it gives you, oh, there is something in our tradition. And there is no point in saying that a tradition is a mere conservatism. It's something going backwards. No. People are doing only Western philosophy. One man will be doing Indian philosophy, not knowing any text at all. It's ridiculous. Such a thing, because I don't know whether a young doctor yesterday, he was giving me a lift, he was asking me who will be going to Kansas again. He asked me, what is the difference you saw? Because I told him I was in Stanford long back. In my 60s I was there for my post-PhD work. What's his name? Oh, you are there. What is the difference? I say that you said that the difference is in the resources. I agreed with him. So look at the resources of our faculty members in the department. It's a shame. It's a shame. For me to say that I am teaching Indian philosophy, but not to know Sanskrit, not to know how to handle a text, do you require anything more regretful than this? All I can say is I don't know, but I have to quote Karl Potter or Elliot Deutsch and say, according to Potter, this is what Shankara says. This is the meaning of the Upanishad. At least I may not be able to say anything about quantum physics, okay? Why not about my own tradition? I must say, this is Shankara, this is Yajnavalkya, this is our tradition. This is the real meaning of the Pancha Mahayagya. Why should be ashamed of speaking about Pancha Mahayagya? Don't listen to the Purohit, he has got a set of views. We respect him, but he has got a circle beyond which he will not be able to move. But we have to, that is our tradition. I will come to that when I take up the question about the deconstruction, how wonderful it is. And I mentioned, I don't go through the analysis step by step. I jump sometimes. And I tell, because there are young scholars here, colleagues, and other people assembled here. Usually I say that, let us look at what is taking place elsewhere. Because usually we have to compare our picture with the picture that is elsewhere. Take Japan. In Japan, in Kyoto, they are developing the Department of Philosophy, like anything. It is called the Kyoto School. I've been there to Kyoto several years ago. And wonderful, the way in which they are bringing up journals. I don't know where they get the money from. Here we say, if there is an Indian philosophy journal, subscribers are very few, we cannot sustain that one.